Good evening, folks.
Thank you so much for being here this evening. I'm Jim Sturgis, the Executive Director of Pioneer Institute, and I welcome you to our 10th annual Hewitt Healthcare Lecture. I'd like to start simply by saying we appreciate the Harvard Medical School's hospitality. Dean Jeffrey Flyer has been a longtime friend to Pioneer Institute, and we deeply appreciate it. This is the 10th annual healthcare lecture that we hold in honor of a man who gave so much of his life to building Pioneer Institute and the capacity and expertise of what is today's Boston, a medical mecca for our country and for the world. I'd like to start by saying thank you to the Hewitt family over here, Chuck and Teak, Colby Hewitt, Josie and John Marston. Thank you so much for all that you do for Pioneer. And helping us to remember your dad, Chuck. So I'd also like to thank our sponsors, the Aiken and D'Asla family, the Hewitt family, Aetna, the Massachusetts Association of Health Underwriters, Fred and Barbara Clifford, Dr. Gary and Susan Kearney, Steward Healthcare System, Tufts Health Plan, and the Association of Behavioral Healthcare, Alosa Health, the Massachusetts Medical Society, Blue Cross Blue Shield, and the Massachusetts Biotechnology Council, and finally, the Atlas Network. So 10 years, in its first decade, this lecture has attracted some of the country's most talented healthcare leaders and thinkers who've shared their views on Romney Care, Obamacare, Chapter 224, cost transparency, price transparency, Medicaid reforms, and other very big picture issues. Tonight is different. We want to focus on something that is in this immediate life right now, every day, proving to be a scourge that is afflicting our communities and forcing us to rethink how we collaborate, how we train our doctors, and how we allocate resources. We are deeply grateful that Secretary Marylou Sudders is here with us. Thank you very much for being here. It's not that she doesn't have anything on her plate. So thank you very much. I'd also like to thank our panelists, Cheryl Bartlett, Dr. Dennis Dimitri, Vic DiGravio, and Sheriff Joe McDonald, and the fabulous moderator that we have for this evening, Deb Becker. Thank you for being here. So just a couple of very brief comments. Whether it's Pittsfield or it's Gloucester or the Cape, local and regional leaders have been wrestling with how to address the epidemic of opioid overdoses. Some of you may have seen as you walked in, there were three placards that depicted a regional approach in Plymouth where Peter Holden of Beth Israel Deaconess, Sheriff McDonald, who's a panelist tonight, and so many other community leaders are implementing a highly coordinated strategy. That is one way of doing things, and we're not saying that's the only way. Folks across the state are trying out stuff. State leaders, too, have responded with new legislation that places limits on opiate prescriptions, establishes a substance abuse evaluation for individuals admitted to an ER for an opioid overdose. It creates programs to monitor opiate prescriptions and also to verbally screen students in public schools, improves training for medical professionals. Look, we're all rolling up our sleeves and trying to figure out how to do this. And I think during the panel discussion, you'll hear about how people on the ground are trying to implement that. It'll be a very interesting conversation. One note I would make is that when I introduce Deb, I'm going to ask the panelists to come up at the same time and sit down here. Before introducing the secretary, I should do one thing in honor of Colby Hewitt, and that is to all the men who have a left collar that has a button on it, if you would do me the great favor of unbuttoning it. And I simply say this because this is something that Colby did because he's a very smart guy. Apologize. I don't mean to be the mayor of New York who does his talks on his phone. Colby had this practice, especially as he got older, that he would unbutton the left collar so that an attractive woman might come up to him and say, "Let me fix that for you." And let me tell you, as you get older, it gets a lot easier, let me tell you. Sorry. Colby liked to laugh, so why not? It's my pleasure to introduce our keynote speaker, Marylou Sudders, Secretary of Health and Human Services, who will help us understand how the state is and will approach this issue. She was appointed Secretary of the Executive Office by Governor Charlie Baker in January 2015. She leads the largest executive agency in state government. It's about half of state government. 20,000 plus people work for her. Her work, the work of the executive office and its affiliated agencies, touch about one in six Massachusetts residents. She is highly equipped for this job. She's dedicated her life to public service. She's been a public official, a provider executive, an advocate. She's taught at college. She was the state's commissioner of mental health, specifically to some of the issues we're dealing with tonight, from 96 to 2003, where she helped create the state's first children's mental health commission. For a decade, she headed the Massachusetts Society for the Protection of Cruelty to Children. I could go on and on. I hope you don't mind, Marylou, if I don't. But we are deeply pleased to have her with us. Thank you for being here. Come on up.
So based on that introduction, I do want to assure all of you I really can hold on to a job. It's my privilege to be with you tonight and to be with the Pioneer Institute, and I want to thank Jim and the Pioneer Institute for all that you do in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. I just have to grab my remarks down here. Hold on. I'll be back. And my glasses. Because I am the oldest person in the governor's cabinet, which was one of those odd, you know, it was one of those odd moments when I looked around the room in the governor's cabinet and the governor and his general counsel, and on one day when we were all being, we were just sort of being loose in the cabinet meeting, and people were going around like the year that they graduated from college and graduate school or whatever, and somebody said, how many people in the room know Lon Povich? Anybody know Lon Povich? Okay. So one of the governor's younger staff said, she can't be older than Lon, to find out that Lon's almost 10 years younger than I am. What are you going to do? On a more serious note, I'm grateful to the Pioneer Institute, and I'll tell you why. Because I see the Pioneer Institute as never being satisfied with the status quo. We share in the commitment of effective government and a strong quality of life in our Commonwealth. And civil discourse is essential to achieving both. And civil discourse is essential to bending the trend of opioid deaths in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. Simplistic fixes will not be effective. Sustainable solutions must be our goal. And yes, that means we have to disrupt the status quo. Frankly, from my perspective, so I'm the independent in the governor's cabinet as well, and anybody who knows me who would probably say that about me. We are fortunate to have a governor who is willing to be bold, decisive, and who uses data to frame the Commonwealth's policy agenda. I am fortunate to have a governor who has stated publicly that he'll stand with me, he'll stand beside me, in back of me, or in front of me, which is really good since he's 6'6". And particularly when it comes to healthcare issues, particularly when some have wondered, what does a social worker know about healthcare or opioids? Presuming that I'm on stage for about 25 minutes, and I won't be, during that time, one more person in the United States will succumb to an opioid overdose. I have a few slides, and I'm not going to read them, but just to give you some facts, maybe. My staff are into animation. You'll see a few of these. So where are we at this juncture? June will mark 1 year since the governor's working group on opioids completed its task. These are just some basic facts. All of you probably know these. So Americans constitute 4.6% of the world's population, but consume 80% of the global opioid supply and 99% of the global hydrocodone supply. Individuals who misuse or depend on alcohol are 2 times, marijuana 3 times, cocaine 15 times, and prescription opioid painkillers are 40 times more likely to have a heroin addiction. 4 out of 5 heroin users started with prescription drugs. somebody tell me if this doesn't work, and of individuals who misuse opioids for a non-medical purpose, 63% obtained from a friend or relative, and 21% were prescribed by one doctor. So as I said, where are we at this juncture? June will mark 1 year since the governor's working group on opioids completed its task. The report was transformed into a 55-point action plan, multi-pronged, multi-year, and for greater detail, you can go online to mass.gov Stop Addiction, because we believe in transparency in this administration, even when the news is not great news. You can check on the report and our updates. The public health framework and strategy adopted were built upon the early good foundational work of the prior administration, and I'd like to acknowledge former Commissioner Cheryl Bartlett, and the legislature, plus a lot of data collection and analysis, expert panels, and professional literature reviews. All of that information was refined by listening to more than 1,100 individuals across the Commonwealth, particularly the experience of loved ones, individuals with addictions, and professionals. We framed addictions for what they are, chronically relapsing medical diseases, not a lack of willpower, a disease. The governor has signed, You can tell, my staff were really getting into this earlier tonight. The governor has signed 5 pieces of legislation, 2 budget bills and 3 policy bills, including most recently in March, Chapter 52 of the Acts of 2016, and you heard Jim sort of catalog a little bit about that, an act relative to substance use, treatment, education, and prevention, or the STEP Act. You know what, I'm just gonna put all this stuff up here. There you go. The STEP Act, which does limit first-time opioid prescriptions with clinical exceptions to 7 days, plus a bill in January ending the practice of civilly committing women for addictions to MCI Framingham, a practice that was promised to end in 1987. So much for political will. Nothing would please me more than to stand here tonight and state that we have bent the trend in opioid-related deaths in the Commonwealth, but we have not yet crested the epidemic. Next week, as part of our commitment to the public, we will be releasing the latest quarterly death data. As the administration continues to refine our data analytic capabilities to inform communities, policymakers, and frontline clinicians, we have recently partnered with the Office of the Chief Medical Examiner to hand count remaining open death cases with undetermined causes of death for 2014 and 2015. We are utilizing the medical examiner's available toxicology data and literally the literal descriptions of death to accomplish this. This expanded effort will result in an increase in the state's 2014 estimated opioid-related overdose deaths from the department's last report. This projection will underscore a tragic and notable increase of opioid-related overdose deaths. Additionally, this expanded death count has brought into sharper relief the state's 2015 estimated opioid-related overdose death numbers, showing a continued upward trend in total cases. Next week's reporting will include several notable enhancements in addition to the medical examiner's toxicology reports. We've never had this information available to us before. The department's publication will include demographic data underscoring this epidemic as a health equity issue that also disproportionately impacts our youth and young adults, as well as continued county-level data which demonstrate the high number of Schedule II and Schedule III opioid prescription per capita. And for the very first time, next week's data will include the fentanyl data, confirming the disturbing relationship between opioid-related deaths and fentanyl, and opioid-related EMS transport data for 2013 to 2015, which closely mirrors trends identified in the state's opioid-related death and naloxone administration data. So next week, These numbers for 2014, 2013, 14, and 15 will dramatically change, and not in the way we would want them to. Equally sobering is that for the first time in decades, life expectancy has declined slightly for white Americans in 2014, as reported today in the New York Times. Analysts of the newly released federal data point to younger and middle-aged whites dying at increased rates from drug-related overdoses. This continued negative momentum is a result of, The continued negative momentum is a result of years of easily accessible prescriptions, the historical minimization of opioid dependency as a side effect to these drugs, the linkage of pain management with fiscal incentives or disincentives, otherwise known as the introduction of the fifth vital sign, the stigmatization of the disease of addictions, compounded by creating a primary treatment path via courts and jails, rather than hospitals and specialty providers. The lack of investment into research and cutting-edge treatments, relying heavily on the abstinence model of treatment for individuals with alcohol dependency. And a ready supply of very cheap and deadly, either pure or cut with fentanyl, heroin. All of these factors contribute to where we are today. That is why we must commit to both a public health approach and a stronger drug interdiction program involving local, state, and federal law enforcement. The STEP Act, which is the bill that the governor most recently signed and Jim mentioned, makes clear that opioid addiction is a disease, a chronically relapsing disease. We don't give up on treating someone with other chronically relapsing diseases, nor should we give up on someone with addictions. We need all the tools in the treatment toolkit across all payers, with the recognition that individuals with addictions are not a homogeneous group. We cannot let up on the sense of urgency. The effect on society, including economic, social, and human costs, is staggering, not only for the individuals struggling with the addiction, but also for families and some of our most vulnerable and youngest citizens, newborns and children. To put this in some context, similar to the rest of the country, Massachusetts is experiencing a greater percentage of newborns diagnosed with substance abuse as substance abuse newborns or with neonatal abstinence syndrome. Up here is the cost. You can see what the cost differential is. Nationally, the prevalence of NAS has almost tripled in 9 years, from 1.2 per 1,000 U.S. hospital births to 3.39 in 2009. The cost of treating these babies is significant. So, where do we go from here? As I would have stated earlier if the dean was here, this year, the deans of our medical schools, along with the dental schools and their professional societies, and I want to thank Dimitri for this, released a pioneering set of medical education core competencies for the prevention and mismanagement of prescription drugs. This is first in the country. 3,000 medical students and 2,300 undergraduate and advanced graduate dental students will receive advanced training. The efforts in Massachusetts have not gone unnoticed regionally and nationally. Earlier this week, the New England governors, along with key staff, teleconference regarding opioids, and to identify common themes to work on together. The governors are very interested in what the medical and dental schools are doing. Other hot topics included the interoperability of prescription monitoring programs across state lines, drug interdiction efforts, best or promising practices, yes, prescription limiting legislation, professional CEU requirements, and public awareness campaigns were headliners with a pledge to work urgently. Government has a strong role in this epidemic, but not a singular one. The governor's plan is a blueprint, subject to change. We welcome new thinking, disruptive to the status quo. We embrace local solutions and national partnerships. This summer, Walgreens Pharmacy will roll out the first national pharmacy drug take-back program in the United States, and Massachusetts is one of the states participating. But government cannot be the only answer to this epidemic. Substance use disorders and addictions do not exist in a vacuum. They often co-occur with mental illness. We, you, together must find new solutions to pain management, emotional and physical pain. Both pains may result in someone's use and subsequent misuse of opioids. In 2014, 4.4 million prescriptions were written by Massachusetts prescribers for our citizens, yielding 240 million opioids in our medicine cabinets, on our streets, and in our hands. Government can regulate and limit prescriptions and mandate CUs or the use of a prescription monitoring program, but the best treatment intervention strategies, research into efficacious treatment, and the next generation of promising practices hail from the medical and behavioral health communities and all of you, those who practice, teach, and engage in research. And as pills are no longer available or too expensive, individuals turn to heroin. Cheap, readily available, and deadly. I have yet to meet someone with addictions who started on heroin, which is why we must also increase law enforcement to deal with traffickers. You, believe it or not, are the experts. We must work together on behalf of our patients and loved ones. We must never forget that behind those numbers is a person. At the moment, we are unfortunately reminded too often of that too late, when we read a family's tribute in an obituary, trying to channel their grief into action. It is up to us, not just government, but all of us. All of our efforts should collectively be geared towards hope, recovery, and pain mitigation for the individual with the addiction, and to offer support and hope for loved ones. One final note, which might be slightly controversial. As we grapple with the opioid epidemic in the Commonwealth, this fall, Massachusetts voters will decide whether to legalize marijuana for recreational purposes. The timing could not be more ironic, frankly. On one hand, Massachusetts, to use the words of tonight's event, facing down the opioid crisis, and on the other, contemplating increasing the availability of marijuana. I would hope that all of us seriously pause before casting your vote. For me, yes, a child of the 60s and 70s, I'll leave it at that, having learned a lot about brain development, addictions, and the like, I stand with the governor, the mayor, and the attorney general as opposed to making marijuana legal. My focus is on the epidemic at hand. Thank you for stepping up to this challenge. Thank you for being willing to listen to me tonight. I'm grateful to be here. Thank you.
Thank you, Marylou. We're going to keep you up there by yourself. Let's move to our panel discussion. It's my pleasure, and if I could ask the panelists to come up as well so Marylou is not lonely. It's my pleasure to introduce our panel moderator, Deb Becker. Deb is a senior correspondent and host at WBUR. Many of you have heard, no, all of you have heard her voice. Take a look at her. This is what she looks like. Her reporting focuses on mental health, criminal justice, and education. Before coming to WBUR, Deb worked at Monitor Radio, the broadcast arm of the Christian Science Monitor newspaper. She also worked at several Boston area radio stations. She has received numerous awards for hosting newscasts, reporting, and investigative reporting from the Radio Television Digital News Association, Public Radio News Directors Incorporated, National Education Writers Association, Associated Press, Corporation for Public Broadcasting, National Alliance on Mental Illness, Parent Professional Advocacy League, and many others. She has completed fellowships on addiction, mental health, juvenile justice, and journalism, and the law. I can think of no one better to moderate our panel discussion today. Thank you, Deb, for being here.
Welcome, welcome. Thank you, Jim, and thank you to the Pioneer Institute for having this event tonight. This is such an important topic. Martha Biebinger was scheduled to be here tonight. Unfortunately, she has the flu, and but both of us have been pretty much assigned to cover this almost exclusively for the past couple of years because there are so many different angles to this story. But I think, as Jim said, we'll probably focus on what do we do now? How do we work together? What do we do that now that we know, and certainly we just heard from Secretary Sudders about what an entrenched problem we have here in Massachusetts, and it's happening around the country. So I'll tell you a little bit about logistics first. Our panel, each panelist will present for about 5 minutes and tell you what they're doing regarding the opioid crisis. Then we'll talk a little bit and we'll open it up for questions. There are two microphones in the room. If you'd like to ask a question, you can go over to one of the mics and feel free to ask one of our panelists to maybe elaborate on something, or if you have a specific question, feel free to do that as well. So let me start by telling you who our panelists are. Of course, they are in your program as well, but Cheryl Bartlett is the former commissioner of the Department of Public Health here in Massachusetts, and she is also now CEO of Alosa Health, where she's responsible for overseeing the organization's programs that focus on developing evidence-based clinical practice guidelines and also ensuring high-quality care for managing chronic conditions. So I think that'll be, she'll have an interesting perspective about how we deal with this. And she's also a nurse and a former hospital administrator. So Cheryl, thanks very much.
Thank you.
Also, Dennis Dimitri, he is a clinical associate professor and vice chair at the Department of Family Medicine and Community Health at UMass Memorial Medical Center in Worcester and the UMass Medical School. He's also president of the Mass Medical Society, and he will talk with us about what medicine is doing regarding the opioid crisis, and also reacting to some of the things that have been proposed about doctors and about prescribing. We saw the statistic that four out of five people who use heroin also started by using prescription opioids. And obviously doctors have something to say about that and have a role in that. And the new legislation from Governor Baker calls for a 7-day limit on the first prescription for opioids. And I think Dr. Dimitri will talk about that as well. Vic DiGravio is with us as well. He's president and CEO of the Association of Behavioral Healthcare. That's more than 80 organizations, community-based mental health and substance use disorder treatment groups. He will be talking about what's happening on the treatment end of things. And Joseph McDonald is the sheriff of Plymouth County, and he was a former assistant district attorney in the county, and he was also public safety representative on Governor Baker's opioid working group. So we have all kinds of perspectives for you tonight, so we'll try to bring it to you as quickly as possible and then let you ask some questions as well. Cheryl, can we start with you?
Thank you. Is this on? Yes. Thank you. I'd like to thank the Pioneer Institute for including me this evening, and I'd also like to say that I'm very proud that Massachusetts was the first state to declare that the opioid overdose deaths in use was a public health emergency and epidemic, and thank Governor Patrick for doing that, and Governor Baker for continuing to have such a priority on this. When we declared this on March 27th, 2014, there was actually an editorial in the New England Journal of Medicine that we had overstepped our authority and power, and no other state in the nation had stepped forward with this bold of an action. And here we are a couple years later with every state in the nation really having declared a public health emergency. And we know that, as Secretary Sudders has mentioned, that about 80% of people that use heroin start their heroin addiction after using a prescribed opiate, mostly not for their own medical use. And so the prescribing of opiates has really been seen as a pathway to heroin addiction. About 15% of the U.S. population used prescription opiates last year, and 11% of the adult population experienced some kinds of chronic pain. 3 to 4% use opiates chronically to try to manage their pain, and between 1999 and 2014, over 165,000 deaths
only for prescription opiates. And so we clearly have an emergency around this particular issue, and what we tend to do, I think, sometimes as public health is the pendulum swings the other way. And so we went through a phase where we were prescribing pain medication on a pretty liberal basis. As a nurse in a hospital, I started my career, we were pretty stingy with giving opiate medication, and we didn't have actually long-acting opiates, which I think really began the rise in opiate addiction and then onto the use of heroin. And as the secretary also mentioned, it became a fifth vital sign. And so, you know, as a society, we valued the management of pain, which is incredibly subjective, to the smiley faces, how pain satisfied were you, and it's really hard to measure that. And actually, many people would say we were measuring the wrong thing, because sometimes with chronic pain, we're never really going to eliminate the pain, but that we should be measuring how functional the individual is. What is the goal of their functional activity, and have we improve that versus have we completely eliminated pain? And we measure quality based on whether or not someone subjectively thinks that their pain has been managed. In some ways, how we pay, someone gets a higher rate of payment if there's better satisfaction from our patients. So I think we collectively as a society have gotten ourselves here, not just those who prescribe us the medication. We advertise directly to consumers. There's a pill for everything, so go to your doctor and ask for that pill and you'll feel better. I think if you watch TV, which I try not to do too often, many of our advertisements are really about medications that will relieve all of the different things that harm us and that we suffer from. And so I think that physicians are in this position where they don't know where to go with this. I don't think most people are intentionally over-prescribing, and the conversations that I've had with prescribers, I think there may be a small percentage of what you would say are pill mill practices, but that most people are empathic to their patients and want to make them comfortable. So how do we teach our providers how to manage pain effectively without the overuse of medications? And so I think that primary care prescribers are either not prescribing, they're referring this to specialties, that if someone needs to go to a pain specialist, we don't have enough pain specialists. So I think we're in this delicate balance where how do we help people who really have pain legitimately and would benefit from an opioid, and how do we make sure that we're not overusing it? And so I'm happy to be at Alosa Health, where what we do there is a not-for-profit that's affiliated with physicians at the Harvard Medical School and the Brigham and Women's Hospital that study epidemiology and pharmacoeconomics, where they do comparative research on the efficacy, safety, and cost of medication for a number of chronic conditions, including chronic pain, where we look at how can we present education to physicians in a manner that will help them to change their practice. And we, quite honestly, we've learned from the pharmaceutical industry. They're very effective at getting physicians to prescribe the latest and greatest of medications. And so Alosa Health puts together the best clinical practice guidelines based on looking at all the evidence. And we know that in a busy primary care practice, if one were to try to stay up to date on all of the latest clinical evidence guidelines, they'd have to read dozens of articles every week in order to do that. So we synthesize the evidence for people. We create the key messages from the different chronic conditions, including chronic pain. And we go door to door, just like a pharmaceutical salesman, and give that one-on-one clinical education in an office practice where we can have an interactive educational session and not just a didactic information, where a lot of randomized clinical trials have shown that practice behavior will change. And so we are out there trying to make a difference one-on-one with prescribers and giving them the tools so that they can practice and help their patients who need pain medication, but to not to over-prescribe. We know that acute pain is very self-limited, so I'm very proud of Massachusetts for passing this bill that limits it to 7 days. It would have been nice to have 3 days. We know that no more than and about 3 days is needed for most acute pain episodes, but 7 days is a good start. And then we also know that there's very little evidence that chronic pain is improved through the long-term use of opioids. I think there's one study that's been a randomized controlled study that went on for longer than 5 weeks that shows how effective or not the chronic pain management is. So I think we need more research in this area. I think we continue to need to support our policymakers to put in place what we need in order to limit access to using opiates as their pathway to becoming addicted to heroin in the long term. And happy to be here as part of this panel and take questions later. Thank you.
Thank you. Dr. Dimitri.
Thank you. And thanks for inviting me to be here today. I've spent a lot of time this last year as the president of the Medical Society speaking about this issue. It has become really the number one public health priority for the Medical Society, and frankly has been our number one priority with regards to just about anything we've done in the last year. So we've been very engaged and very involved and certainly very concerned. Secretary Sudders has stolen a little of my thunder with some of what she talked about, so I'll try not to be repetitive. But having talked about this subject a lot, there are a lot of different kinds of things that I could highlight. I'm actually going to go even a little further back than you did, Cheryl, in terms of history, just for a moment, because it's oftentimes important to realize where we've been to understand where we are now. And interestingly, back at the turn of the last century, there was an epidemic of morphine derivative or opium derivative addiction, primarily in upper middle class women in the Northeast, kind of interesting considering where we are now. And opium products were actually available over the counter for a wide variety of ills. And that resulted in many people getting into trouble with opium and other derivatives. And it resulted in the first controls. We talked about the laws that we have just passed recently, but back a little over 100 years ago, some of the first state controls came into place. By the 1940s, you couldn't buy opium products over the counter any longer. You had to get a physician prescription to do so. And as recently as 1973, the DEA came into existence. I didn't really know how recent the DEA was until I started looking into the history of control of substances here in the United States. Richard Nixon created the DEA as part of the war on drugs. And an outcome of that was that in the last couple decades of the 20th century, physicians actually dramatically decreased the amount of prescribing they did with respect to opium derivatives such as morphine and some of the synthetic drugs like Percocet, Vicodin that you've all heard of, to such a degree that we heard patients literally say, even though they were dying of cancer, that a doctor wouldn't prescribe a pain-relieving medication to them because they were afraid of causing addiction. So clearly, physicians were having a real struggle with understanding the data back 30 or 40 years ago as to what was reasonable and what was not with respect to prescribing. And physicians are in a very unique position, I think, because we have to balance both trying to relieve the pain and suffering of our patients with the recognition that we may be putting some of them at risk for addiction by our prescriptions. And we very early on in this most recent effort to change legislation did testify before the governor's commission that we wanted to be sure that we were not ignoring those patients who really needed relief versus the problem that clearly was happening with overprescribing of opioids. So we ended up with this perfect storm of, as you said, the fifth vital sign, physicians being judged on how well they were relieving pain, experts educating physicians, and I use that word guardedly, that it was okay to prescribe long-acting opioids for chronic non-malignant pain, something that I think was a big mistake, but the data that was used at that time was conflicting at the least, if not misleading. And so we ended up with physicians prescribing increasing numbers of opioids, such that over the last 15 years, the prescribing rate has gone like this. The addiction rate has followed right behind that. And very unfortunately, the number of people dying from opioid overdoses has followed very closely. Are we prescribing too many opioids? I don't think there's any question that that is indeed the case. And we need to address that. So actually in 2014, the Massachusetts Medical Society formed a task force to take a look at the issue of opioids and communication between and among physicians about opioid prescribing. So we had started looking at this issue a year and a half ago, actually before Governor Baker was elected. But shortly after Governor Baker was elected, we had an opportunity to meet with him, Secretary Sudders, and others, and it was quite clear that we at the Medical Society needed to take ownership for the piece of this that physicians were responsible for, and that was taking a very careful look at what was going on with opioid prescribing. How could we create an environment where our patients who legitimately needed to be treated for cancer, end-of-life pain, post-operative pain, acute injury could get what they needed, but at the same time, we raise the awareness of physicians about the dangers of overprescribing of opioids. So the things that we have done have included creating a set of guidelines that address issues of both management of acute and chronic pain, that talk about using the minimal amount of opioid for the shortest period of time. I will say there's actually pretty lousy data about whether 3 days or 5 days or 7 days is the right number. But a short course for most people with acute pain is certainly sufficient, and we want our physicians to be aware of the fact that they can get they can be prescribing lesser amounts of opioids and still be taking care of their patients with acute pain. Those guidelines were disseminated to physicians all across the state, and we think that really raised awareness. The another specific action that we took was to make available more education for prescribers of whether they were members of our medical society or not. One of the things that we know is that many physicians don't feel like they have enough knowledge about prescribing opioids, how to do it safely, when to do it, how to identify patients who are dependent or becoming addicted, which are not exactly the same thing, by the way, and also how to treat those patients or help those patients find treatment who have become addicted. We put out lots of CME information on our website. Something like 3,500 individuals have downloaded a total of about 10,000 courses on our continuing medical education regarding opioids, so we feel like we've gotten the word out to prescribers. We also did a real effort to educate the public. So on our website, we initially put a lot of information out about safe storage and disposal of opioids. One of the things that you heard is that many people who misuse an opioid are doing it with an opioid that was prescribed to somebody else. And once that realization was made, it became very important for us to get the word out to the public that if you've got opioids in your medicine cabinet, you need to guard them, and when you don't need them anymore, you need to get rid of them in a safe fashion. So we spent a lot of time educating the public about that, and then we changed our public service announcements to also emphasize that patients should talk to physicians about alternatives to opioids for managing their pain, and should not be reluctant to talk about their talk with their physicians about the risks of taking opioids, the risk of addiction, so that there's a good conversation taking place between physicians and their patients with regards to this issue. As you heard from Secretary Sudders, we also helped convene the four deans of the medical schools here to work on a curriculum of education for medical students in Massachusetts at all four of the state's medical schools. That now has also actually gone over to the dental schools as well. And One of the things that we know is that the students of today are clamoring for information about this. They are acutely aware of the crisis that's going on, and they want to be well educated about how to safely use opioids when they need to, and how to help their patients, their future patients, when they when they identify individuals who have problems due to addiction going forward in the future. So we've also seen a real change in the medical literature. It was very interesting to hear you comment about what was in the New England Journal about 2 years ago now, I guess, because I this folder I have here, as I was reading material to prepare for this, in the New England Journal in the last several weeks, there have been multiple articles about opioids and how to mitigate risks associated with them. And one of the articles talked in particular about, number one, the need to use evidence addressing this issue. I was very glad to hear that we have a data-driven governor. Let me tell you that medicine is also driven by data. We like to try and practice based on evidence. So one of the things that we need is more evidence about how to use opioids safely when they are really indicated, and more importantly, how to avoid getting people into trouble with addiction to opioids, and then for those unfortunate individuals who are already addicted, how do we help them out? A second piece of advice about mitigation is the one that we've already addressed here, which is education of medical students. This is not something that is embedded in medical school curricula all across the United States, but it is here in Massachusetts. We are going to, some of the deans here are going to report out to the Association of Medical Colleges on what we've done, so that we hope we will see national spread on this issue. And then the third piece is really more research on pain. We know that pain is a very common symptom. It is one of the most common reasons why patients show up in a doctor's office. We need to better understand pain, both in terms of its physiology and as well as the psychology and sociology of why some individuals are more troubled by pain and are more at risk for addiction. And with research around those areas, we can be more safe in what we do. And the other piece of the research needs to be, what are the alternatives to opioids for treatment of pain? Some of them are already out there. There are things like cognitive behavioral therapy. There are things like exercise and physical therapy. There are complementary things like acupuncture. All of those are tools that we as physicians need to use. I will put one plug in here and say that we hope that we can get the government here in Massachusetts to help us with the insurers, make sure that all of those things are covered, because sometimes they're not. So some of those alternatives are not as easily available, unfortunately, to patients as getting a pill. I'll be glad to answer questions and elaborate on some of that, but that's mostly what we've been busy with.
Okay, sounds like you've been busy. Vic DiGravio.
Thank you, Deb, and I'd also like to thank the Pioneer Institute for inviting me here tonight. It's an honor to be here. It's actually an honor to be sitting next to Secretary Sudders, who I believe is the first Secretary of Health and Human Services ever to have run an ABH member organization in a prior life. So,
And survived it.
We take great pride in the fact that the Secretary was a member of our association for many years. As Deb mentioned, we're a statewide association. We have 85 member organizations across the Commonwealth, all the way out to the Berkshires and everywhere in between there and Boston. Our members really are the Commonwealth system of community-based behavioral health care, providing both mental health and addiction treatment services through contracts with the Department of Mental Health, the Department of Public Health, Bureau of Substance Abuse Services, and then also MassHealth. Our members really are on the front lines of this epidemic and have been for many, many years. In terms of addiction treatment services, our members really provide a full spectrum. And we're fortunate in Massachusetts that I think the good news is that we've got a solid foundation and a continuum of care. When I go to meetings with my colleagues from across the country, they really are incredibly impressed with what we have in place in Massachusetts. And that's credit to the legislature, to the previous administration, Commissioner Bartlett, and certainly to Governor Baker and Secretary Sudders. It's really important to note that this epidemic, state government has not been asleep at the switch. If you look at state appropriations for addiction treatment over the past 12 to 13 years, they've increased significantly. The challenge is that the epidemic has grown faster than state appropriations. So I think that's a really important piece to keep in mind. Our members, as Deb said, we focus on treatment. The two key messages we always like to share with folks, one is that treatment can and does work. That's a really important message for people to hear. And the other is that only roughly one out of every 10 individuals that needs treatment is actually in treatment. And part of that is because a number of those nine, the remaining nine individuals, some of them haven't come to the realization that they need treatment yet, but the rest of them can't access treatment. So a lot of our focus with the Association for Behavioral Health Care is on expanding access to treatment. In 2014, we worked very closely with Commissioner Bartlett in the legislature to pass and enact landmark legislation, Chapter 258 of the Acts of 2014, which mandates access to detox and detox step-down benefits for both MassHealth members and commercially insured individuals in Massachusetts. That was a really important step because what we had heard, our members had from our members, and what policymakers heard from family members is despite folks having what they thought was really good insurance, they struggled to get their loved ones into treatment, into detox step-down treatment. So the legislature, working again with Commissioner Bartlett and the Patrick administration, passed that bill. Secretary Sudders, I think one of the very first things she took on, even before the task force, was really aggressively implementing Chapter 258 and making sure that there was clear guidance from the Division of Insurance and MassHealth to insurers about what was expected of them, not just the letter of the law, but the spirit of the law. So the provisions of Chapter 258 went into effect last October, October 1st, which we think when, as it's being implemented and over the next few years, will really open up access to the front door for treatment, people in need of detox and detox step-down services. So what, as an association, we've begun to focus on over the past 18 months or so is more downstream services, access to downstream services, because we know all the data shows the longer somebody is actively engaged in treatment, the better chance they have of maintaining their sobriety. And there's clear data from the Department of Public Health that if somebody is in detox step down for 15 to 20 days, the better chance they have to get to the next level of treatment. The challenge is we do have a bottleneck. With Chapter 258, prior to passage of Chapter 258, in FY15, there were approximately 22,000 individuals in Massachusetts that were admitted to detox programs, licensed detox programs in the state. That number dropped to approximately 5,600 in admissions to detox step down. So as a result, we had people cycling through detoxes. Detox is not addiction treatment, it's a medical procedure. And I think we have, for 22,000 individuals, we had roughly 47,000 admissions to detox. Chapter 258 was designed to alleviate that bottleneck to get people to the next level of treatment at step down. And now we're working on transitional support services, residential recovery homes. Outpatient treatment is a key piece of this. As the Secretary mentioned earlier, medication-assisted treatment. That's another huge piece of the puzzle. For too long, there's been a division in the treatment community between abstinence-only and medication-assisted treatment. I think we've made great strides, especially in Massachusetts, over the past 4 or 5 years in helping to bridge that divide. But really, as the Secretary said earlier, addiction is a disease. And to think that we should expect individuals to treat their addiction without medication is really, there's no other disease we would say that about. Now, certainly medication-assisted treatment may not work for everybody. Abstinence-only programs work very well for some folks, but we do need every tool in the toolbox to fight this epidemic.
Can I just interrupt you for a second?
Sure.
Just to explain, medication, you mean Suboxone and methadone primarily?
Vivitrol.
Vivitrol.
No, thanks, Deb. That's a good question.
You might want to explain that.
The three medication-assisted treatments are methadone maintenance, which are delivered in opioid treatment programs, which are probably the most highly regulated healthcare delivery. It's regulated federally by the DEA. It's regulated by the state. And then more recently, development of Suboxone, which can be administered, prescribed through primary care practices. And then Vivitrol, which is actually an injectable, which is was originally developed for alcoholism and more recently developed for opioids. So access to medication-assisted treatment is a huge piece of the puzzle. The other thing that we're hearing more and more, as our members start to get more people into treatment, what they're also talking about is after the active treatment ends, the recovery home, the importance of having individuals have access to supportive case management and supportive housing. That's what a lot of our members that run recovery home services, and recovery homes are places where folks can be anywhere from 5 to 10 months, depending on the individual's need. It's an opportunity for an individual to get back on their feet economically, get back into the workplace, get back into the, resume their education, repair familial relationships and personal relationships. But a lot of our members are hesitant to discharge people from that level of care because folks don't have good housing options. Their lives have been in chaos for so long that they just don't have safe places to go. And that's something that we've begun to talk to the Secretary about. Commissioner Burrell has actually formed a working group on that, Commissioner Monica Burrell at Public Health. So that's another key piece of the puzzle is what happens when the active treatment ends. And then finally, just to wrap up, I think the Secretary also mentioned earlier individuals who are duly diagnosed with a mental health disorder and an addiction disorder. That's something that more and more our members are seeing on a daily basis. It's always been a high overlap, but our members are seeing even greater numbers of people presenting with co-recurring disorders, histories of trauma, and that requires special skills and special services. And the other exciting thing, which I think the Secretary did not mention, is that the state is pursuing a federal waiver, Medicaid waiver, to allow MassHealth to expand the options for treatment through MassHealth, including residential programming, but also treatment programs for individuals with co-occurring disorders. So that's another key piece of the puzzle.
Thank you. Sheriff McDonald.
Institute for inviting me to participate. It's my honor to be here. I want to thank you all for coming out and showing interest in what I think is a very vital issue that we need to get a handle on. And I want to say how nice it is for me to be reunited with my colleague, the Secretary Sudders, who I had the pleasure of serving on the working group with her under her direction. And really, I have to say I was constantly amazed at her level of commitment, her level of knowledge, and really the work that was done was a credit, not just to all of us, but to her as well. So thank you, Madam Secretary. I appreciate that. I am, I've been introduced, I am the sheriff in Plymouth County. I am one of 14 sheriffs. I am the immediate past president of the Massachusetts Sheriffs Association. I am the current vice president. And I'm here to tell you that all 14 sheriffs share our concern. What would a sheriff have to add to this is a question that you may have thought of as you looked at this. You know, I'm not someone who necessarily works in a public health field, but when you think about it, what the sheriffs do, and sheriffs are unique throughout the country, but also in Massachusetts. As I stated, there are 14 of us. 13 of us have correctional facilities of varying sizes. The only county in Massachusetts that does not have a correctional facility is Nantucket. Martha's Vineyard does have one. And the rest of us, we're varying sizes. Plymouth County is one of the larger correctional facilities. Our capacity is somewhere in the vicinity of about 1,700 inmates. And I'm happy to tell you that as of today, our populations throughout the correctional system as a whole have been declining, and somewhat substantially. So I'm happy to tell you, as I sit here today, our population in Plymouth County is somewhere in the vicinity of about 1,100 inmates. So those numbers are going down. But what brought me and gave me interest in this particular topic, I have been the sheriff for 11 years. And prior to being the sheriff, I was 9 years an assistant district attorney in Plymouth County. And I prosecuted cases in all of the district courts and in the superior court throughout Plymouth County. And I used to think of the drug issues in a very traditional way. I dealt with them firsthand in the courts. I prosecuted them every day. And when I became the sheriff, my thinking really hadn't changed that much, so that when people would come to me or approach me and say, how many individuals are finding themselves in your custody as a result of drug use or alcohol abuse? And I would think of that very traditionally, so I could quantify that. I could get those numbers. How many people were there for the possession of drugs? How many people were there for the manufacture or the distribution of drugs? How many people were there for the trafficking of drugs? Those numbers are easy to quantify, but they really don't tell, I would say, not the whole story, they don't tell much of the story. Because what I have found as I have worked in this field is that virtually, and I have some statistics that I brought with me that are currently being compiled under the direction of Sheriff Tompkins, who is the current president of the Sheriff's Association, the sheriff here in Suffolk County. We have, and this is self-reporting, which you know is going to be lower, I think, than reality, 72% of our admissions are admitting or indicating substance abuse issues. 72%, that's a gigantic number. And I have to think that that number is going to be larger than that. And when you think about that, you realize that so many people are there, not technically for drug crimes, but they may be there for crimes, property crimes, theft, breaking and entering, these types of things. Individuals who would never have committed these acts but for the fact that they were seeking to get money or items to sell to feed that drug habit. Creating victims, and those, as we all know, the first victims that these individuals create are their family members, who are less likely to report that and certainly less likely to cooperate in a prosecution. So that's a terrible side effect. But then also crimes of domestic violence or crimes of violence outside in the community that individuals participate in, that commits acts that are committed that these people would never have dreamed of committing were they not under the influence of drugs. So my thinking has changed very, very substantially, so that when I am asked that question now, how many people are in my custody as a result of drug abuse or alcohol abuse, my answer to that has changed very differently. It's now most of the individuals in our custody are there for that reason. So knowing that, and all of the sheriffs are conscious of this, knowing that we as a group, the sheriffs, are committed to seeing that, you know, we understand that these individuals are presenting with these issues, and whatever our population is, something we must be conscious of is that 99% of those people who are currently residing in a house of correction are coming back into our communities. So it's incumbent upon us, you know, perhaps we are the area of last resort, but it's incumbent upon us to engage those people in treatment programs. And to that end, you know, in Plymouth County, we've done a lot of innovative things in partners with our local, with the Beth Israel Deaconess Hospital there in Plymouth, with our local police departments, their clergy, the district attorney's office. But we, the sheriffs themselves, I know it was mentioned, we talked about Medicaid, looking for waivers. When individuals come into the custody of either Department of Corrections or of the sheriffs, their mass health is discontinued, it's cut off. so that that person, when they are looking to get out back into the community, and obviously we're thinking about reentry, knowing that 99% of those folks are coming back, day one we have to start planning for their reentry into our community. And it's most important to us that they engage in meaningful and helpful programming. And we want to give them the best opportunity when they get on the outside so that they will have a viable and a good life, but also they're not creating any more victims of crime. That's what this is really all about for us. So we, under the leadership of Sheriff Katusian from Middlesex County, are working on legislation that's going to help us, rather than having to have that person fill out a 30-page form to get that mass health back in place, we're looking to be able to throw a switch so that as soon as they walk out the door, they're going to be covered for whatever counseling or aftercare they're going to need when they leave our custody. This makes perfect sense to all of us, but we don't want them to get tied up in these bureaucratic nightmares, this red tape that really should not exist. So we're working on those. I know it's been mentioned also about the medically assisted treatments, Vivitrol. I want to give credit to Sheriff Jim Cummings down in Barnstable County. Sheriff Cummings brought all of the sheriffs together. We have monthly meetings where we all do get together several years ago and educated all of the sheriffs about something called, something I'd never heard of, called Vivitrol. And they've been using it down there in Barnstable County to great success. So I think you're going to be seeing these types of programs everywhere, and I'm hopeful that you're going to see that. Some of the other stuff that we've done in Plymouth County, we partnered with the District Attorney's Office, with Covanta Energy, the Department of Public Health, and all of our police departments, and we now have drug take-back boxes in all of our police departments so that individuals who have those things at home, I consider, you know, when you look in a medicine cabinet and see these old prescriptions, to me, you know, I don't see pills, I see unexploded ordnance. I want to get that out there. It's like a bomb. Get rid of it, dispose of it properly. We're doing that in Plymouth County, and I want to give a shout-out to the city of Brockton. They were the one city that had a difficult time locating that boxes in the take-back boxes in the lobby of the police departments. Their lobby was a little bit too small, so what Brockton has done is they have gone on the road. So they have two police officers who will go to various places within the city of Brockton and do the take-back. So they, Brockton is very proactive, and I want to give a shout-out to Chief Crowley down there and Mayor Carpenter, who also served with us on the working group. So we've got that. We've got we've come up with an opiate task force in Plymouth County. We've got many groups that are part of that. We've got the district attorney is a co-chair with myself. Our police chiefs are involved. Our legislators are involved. Clergy is involved. Educators. And many of our local opiate fighting groups are involved, Learn to Cope. Many of the different towns have groups. What we're trying to do is coordinate our efforts on a countywide basis so that rather than having individual groups in individual towns or regions competing with each other for grant money, we're collaborating and making a much stronger application for any of those grant monies that we could, much better than we could do individually. So it's in its infant stages. It's something that we're hopeful is going to bear fruit, and we're looking forward to traveling around and letting people know about that. Something else that was mentioned, and I saw some boards about this out as I came into the auditorium here, the innovative stuff that's being done as part of our task force in Plymouth County through the Beth Israel Deaconess Hospital down there. And Plymouth Police, I have to give credit to Plymouth Police and Chief Mike Boteri, Peter Holden from Beth Israel Deaconess. They are engaging in a process now when someone, when an individual overdoses, and normally it's not dealt with at that time as a police matter, but the next day, the police department will go there, and they don't send cruisers with lights and uniforms and guns, the whole, very low key, they visit, and what they're finding, that even though there may be people who in the emergency room when they present with an overdose want nothing to do with treatment, nothing to do with any officials, nothing to do with the medical professionals, they just want to get out of there, go home and be left alone. We are finding that the vast majority of individuals when they are approached the next day are opting to go into treatment, and it's really been an eye-opening experience. We were in a meeting of the task force this past week. Chief Boteri, who was being funny about this, who would say that these individuals were telling the doctors and the police officers right after they had been Narcan'd out of their overdose would say, I definitely don't want to see you at my house on 34 Court Street, second floor, third room on the left. Do not dare come over to see me. So you can really tell that these types of things are working. And, you know, I'm glad to be a partner with them, with my fellow sheriffs. I look forward to, there's a zillion things I haven't thought to speak of, but I want to find out if there are any questions that you all have with reference to the things that we're doing. One last thing that I will mention that we are doing in Plymouth, and I'm hoping to see it emulated elsewhere. As I said, our populations in the correctional system have been declining. And I'm happy about that for many reasons, and my colleagues, and I agree that this is part of it, that our rehabilitative programs are working. So I'm glad to see that those numbers decrease. But what that's going to leave us with is a resource that is underutilized or unutilized. And one of the things that we've done is partnered with our colleagues at the Department of Correction. They operate the MASAC unit over in Bridgewater. So that what we've done is taken some empty space, some fallow space in the Plymouth Correctional Facility, and we have dedicated that to civilly committed treatment beds. So we've got 50 beds there, and we're hoping that we're going to be able to double that capacity within the next month or so that individuals who are committed by a judge for a period of time are going to be able to stay within that secure facility and complete that course of treatment before they're turned out onto the streets. So we've made a lot of progress. We have a long way yet to go, but I'm glad to be part of the process, and I'm honored to be here. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. All right, I'm going to ask you a few questions, but I'm going to also ask you to be brief so we don't run out of time, so the audience will also have time for questions as well. You know, we've just heard some really staggering numbers, and it sounds like the numbers that Marylou told us about at the start of this are only going to get worse in terms of overdose deaths, but also numbers in terms of people getting treatment, numbers of people who go into detox and then go on to further treatment. Is treatment the problem, really, in terms of figuring out how best to deal with people who have addiction, and how do we measure the quality of that? So first, what I want to ask you, Vic, is what do we need to do to shore up treatment, because we've obviously got a big problem and it seems to be getting worse. And then, Cheryl, I'm wondering if you can tell me, because you look at evidence-based ways of dealing with chronic conditions, how do we look at quality and measure it and know that somebody is actually getting the treatment that they need to try to stop this? So, Vic, I'd like to start with you.
Sure. So I think, and I'm not sure if this will be a popular answer, but I think one of the most important way to expand access to treatment, it's going to cost money. It's going to cost money either through state appropriations or through insurance coverage. The state, again, the state has invested significantly in the treatment continuum. Recently this year, the reimbursement rates for recovery homes were increased significantly, which most of these provider organizations are nonprofits, but they do need to break even to provide services. So creating more access is a function of funding to a great extent. And then I think we need to also look at what's working innovatively. I think one of the flip side of having an underfunded system for so long is that a lot of providers have been very creative and very innovative in trying to cobble together systems of care. And I think we should be looking to those lessons to replicate what providers have done on the ground. It's something we've talked a lot to MassHealth about as they've talked about accountable care organizations and making sure that we leverage existing resources and community expertise. But I think to a great extent, it's a function of funding.
And how do we know what works?
And as a follow-up to that is I hosted 13 opiate roundtables across the state to learn about what all people were thinking about treatment and access to it. And what I came to find was beds became symbolic for needing treatment of some sort. And it may not be that everyone needs to be in a 24-hour-7 residential treatment for opioid use disorder. we're basing our system of care on alcohol treatment. And I think that opioid use disorder is different. So the bed really was often symbolic for the family or the worried mother who wanted their kids somewhere that was safe, that they weren't going to worry that they were going to overdose. And so in a bed somewhere that people were taking care of them seems like the best thing to do. And that's not to say we don't need more beds, but I don't think we've ever really analyzed what the number of beds are that's adequate to treat this problem here in Massachusetts. We're third best in the nation for access to treatment. But I'd argue that when we say beds, sometimes it's about there's no one to pay for it. So it's that they're someone on Medicaid or a public payer, and the only bed available is for someone with private insurance or can fork out $30,000 themselves for somebody in their family to go for treatment. So that no bed available, really you have to tease that information to find out the problem. So I could guarantee you if I needed treatment right now and I had $30,000 to $40,000, somebody would take me into treatment probably right now. But if I had Medicaid or I couldn't pay, you would go on a waiting list. So that I think we really need to resolve. And then I would say,
is there a difference between the $30,000 treatment and the other treatment? Like, how do you know what's
not really, but what the system does is you need a payer mix, and I don't necessarily even blame the treatment facilities, because in order for them to stay alive financially, they need a payer mix that is a combination of private and public payer, no different than an acute care hospital. If everyone went into all of our acute care hospitals that only had public payers, we would have a lot less number of hospitals here in Massachusetts. So just so that we clearly understand when we're solving the problem, what are we trying to solve? And I think, as Vic mentioned earlier, this removal of pre-authorization requirement will get more people into treatment, and hopefully we'll learn from that. Is this a bed problem, or is this a payer problem, or what percentage is it of which? And then I'd argue that stigmatization of medication-assisted treatment is part of the problem. If you look at data, about 90% of 10% of our treatment facilities really support medication-assisted treatment. So we're 90% an abstinence-based model, where if you look at data from methadone clinics, we've had methadone around for over 40 years. There's a lot of data. About 85% of people are not successful with an abstinence-based model. So the model doesn't fit the disease. And so we really need to do more about that. And even I would say at Alosa, we haven't really looked at how to create clinical practice guidelines about the best way to treat people with medication-assisted treatment. Vivitrol is relatively new to us, and I think a lot of people have said, well, that's it. That's the magic bullet. One shot a month, and we've got the problem solved. But I just read a study recently that Vivitrol, by the end of a year, in the one clinical trial that I looked at, had the same outcomes as somebody that didn't get into any kind of medication-assisted treatment. So we need more data in order to know what is the true problem that we're trying to solve for. So I think that it's a little bit of all of those things, but we need to destigmatize the treatment. We stigmatize the person with addiction, and then we stigmatize the treatment. I think somebody mentioned earlier, how many chronic conditions do we not give medications for? Diabetic needs to take their insulin or their oral medication every day, and if they don't follow their diet, we don't say to them, well, you just didn't follow your diet one time too many, you can't go into treatment today for your ketoacidosis. We would treat you one more time. And so we have a lot of work to do to move the treatment system along.
I'm wondering, Sheriff McDonald, I know you spoke about Vivitrol, which is the monthly injection that's supposed to eliminate cravings, but the other medication-assisted treatment that folks take to sort of wean them off opioids, the methadone and the Suboxone, those I've read that you don't support. So why is that?
Well, it's not so much that I would say that they are not something to be used. I agree with my colleagues who say we want to use everything in the toolbox. I think that that should be a tool of last resort. To the extent that we can get people off of any of these substances, I think that abstinence should be the goal. But again, agreeing with Cheryl, for individuals that, for whatever reason, are unable to make a go, I certainly would be supportive of them using those. But I think part of the problem, from the way I see it, is that we too easily fall into that model and then consider the problem solved. So to me, someone who was addicted to heroin who is now on methadone, certainly they're much safer and you know their risk of dying is much less, but I would hesitate. I don't want to stop there and declare victory. I want to continue with that person and see if we can step them down off of the methadone to be drug free.
If we go back to the prescribing end of things, Dr. Dimitri, I'd like to ask you this. What are we seeing as a result of the new state initiatives, the limit on first-time opioid prescriptions, and evaluating folks when they go into the emergency room for, you know, 24 hours if they are going in after an opioid overdose? What are medical professionals seeing? How's that playing out?
Well, I think it's too soon to know exactly what's going to happen with this in terms of outcomes, but certainly across the state, physicians have become well aware of the fact that they need to be more scrupulous in looking at the way they're prescribing. And so the physicians are well aware of the fact that the new law went into effect with respect to limits on first prescriptions of what are called Schedule 2 and 3 narcotics. That mostly means drugs you've heard of like oxycodone, hydrocodone, Percocet, Vicodin, et cetera. With respect to the 24-hour evaluation in emergency departments or hospitals, if you present with overdose or other evidence of addiction, that actually hasn't gone into effect yet. It will go into effect this summer. But what we expect to see is that emergency departments, hospitals, and other such organizations will put into place systems so that they will be able to, in a timely fashion, and the requirement is within 24 hours, make available to those individuals who present with overdose the opportunity to get into treatment programs. Those individuals can voluntarily stay at the hospital for up to 24 hours or until they're until they receive the treatment that they need and are evaluated by an appropriate provider of services for addiction. And that's a little bit of a contrast from the some of the earlier suggestions about involuntary hospitalization, something that was not only pragmatically a little trouble to figure out how to implement that, but also you have to get people at the right time. And as was mentioned earlier, it's kind of interesting that somebody may not want to immediately access treatment for their addiction when they're waking up from their Narcan relief of their overdose. But if you can catch them a little bit later and maybe reach out to them, I think that would be a really great way to make sure that we follow up with these patients because we may have a greater success when perhaps they're not just emerging from the throes of their overdose and then the sudden withdrawal because of the Narcan they've been given. If I could say one other thing about treatment, mm-hmm. There's another place on the spectrum where a different kind of treatment can play a role. Medication-assisted treatment with Suboxone in mostly primary care settings. These are individuals who clearly have major issues with having developed tolerance to medications and are on the verge of moving over to addiction to medication. And I will speak from personal experience in what we're doing in our family medicine department. We have developed in our clinics what's referred to as integrated primary care, where there's a family physician and a psychologist or other behavioral health specialist working side by side. And in those settings, we can particularly address the kinds of individuals who have dual diagnoses, people who have anxiety or depression or other mental health issues and substance abuse. And the use of Suboxone in that setting by their own primary care doctor in the clinic where they go to get all their other medical problems taken care of can be very helpful. And that's a group of patients who haven't gotten to the point where they may really need inpatient care or other more serious interventions. And that's another piece of treatment that we need to keep our eyes on.
Okay.
Can I just...
Yeah, I was going... Actually, I think we're almost out of time. I figured you had the first word, so I'd give you the last word as well, right? But you may...
No. So just a couple of things, and I want to talk a little bit about the emergency room. So if anyone in the room has ever been involved in legislation, unless it's a simple piece of legislation like the naming of a building, where what you wrote is probably what's passed and signed into law, that the STEP Act, the bill that was signed into law in March, is a big, comprehensive, and in some parts of it is a complicated piece of legislation. And legislation of that kind is sort of like sausage making. And I actually, and I'll just be completely honest about this, and it's not because we didn't propose this and so I'm not happy about what happened, but I actually think one of the unintended consequences of what passed is actually going to be this 24-hour in emergency rooms. That the very things that emergency room physicians were worried about, of people being in their emergency rooms and sort of stuck, is exactly, is potentially what's going to happen come July. It was not what was proposed in the governor's bill. We proposed something that was a little bit more disruptive and obviously not comfortable for the legislature and folks in the Mass Medical Society, emergency room physicians, to accept. And, you know, we understand that. This is complicated stuff, as you're hearing. But I actually, one of the pieces I actually am worried about is actually the 24 hours in emergency room, which was going to actually have the effect that people were hoping would not, which is people in emergency rooms actually being sort of held for 24 hours and not actually getting into treatment. So I'm hoping I'm wrong about that, but it is actually one of the things I think we're all going to need to watch very carefully and be honest if it's not effective and sit at the table and come up with an alternative. So since I get the last word, so one thank you is there has never been sufficient, if you think about behavioral health issues, addictions and mental illnesses, so for every dollar invested in research in the United States, about one penny has been invested in understanding the science behind mental illnesses and addictions. So we are very much in sort of a catch-up mode, both in terms of treatments, what works, the quality, the effectiveness of treatments, what's out there and available. And it's going to take us a while to get this right. So I would encourage all of us to be really present about this. If you do nothing else tonight, I would ask you to go home and look in your cabinets, in your medicine cabinets. And if you have unused opioids and you say, you know, I might need that someday, the reality is there are ways you can dispose of it. You can go on to the Mass Medical website. You can go on to my website. You can see how you can do without even having to go down to the police department to get rid of medications. If nothing else tonight, do that. If you have somebody in your family that you're worried about, don't be scared of talking to them. But just put it out there. When you go to your doctor's offices for your annual physical exams, at mine, I get a depression screen. I know it because I'm in the field, so I sort of know what the five questions are, and the first time it ever happened to me, I asked my physician, are you doing this because you're worried about me? Are you doing this because mental illness runs in my family, which it does? And or third, is a part of your primary care practice. One of the things our primary care doctors need to do is to also screen all of us for whether we have a history, a family history, or perhaps some reason why addictions may be part of our life. So I want you to leave with a message of hope tonight, because this is probably a little, you know, sobering to all of us. But there are things each and every day, each of us, whether you're in this field or not, can be engaged in. And I would encourage you to keep all of us in government on our toes about this, but there are things that you can do. And I just want to leave you with that message. All of us are completely in this, and many people in this room. But just as when somebody says, well, what can I do? Just open your medicine cabinet. Talk to your kid. Talk to your family member if you're worried. And next time you go to for your annual physical exam, ask your doctor why it is they're not asking you about whether you have a family history of addictions or mental illness, and why are we not being screened for that. It's one of the most disabling conditions in our country, and it's actually one of the most treatable if we can get treatment. So thank you.
I just want to say that I think that our panelists were terrific, and you can see that it's this is a problem that's got a huge scope. We've got the medical field, the criminal justice field, we've got policymakers, we've got clinical researchers, we've got a lot of people working on this. So thank you very much. I think that you really added a lot to this conversation, and thank the Pioneer Institute, and I think Chuck Hewitt's going to say a few final words and goodbye. Thanks to all of you as well. Do we have time? I just wasn't sure. It's 8:04.
Are there two quick questions?
Okay. Is that okay? Okay.
Let me raise the libertarian perspective. And that is, first of all, it seems to me that adults ought to be able to take what they want. And secondly, the history of government programs is that once they start, they always expand ad infinitum. Some of the stuff that you were talking about, of course, is very worthwhile and very important. But already I hear the closing in on the people who are innocent, as it were. I'm hearing about we should go to our medicine cabinet, that we should vote against legalization of marijuana. I don't know what the percentage is of people in the Commonwealth who have an addiction problem, but I suspect it's a small percentage of the total population. And the question is whether the rest of us who don't should be penalized for the small minority that do. Nobody talks now about banning alcohol, although that's one of the substance abuses, because it gave rise to the domestic underworld. We've had decades of the war on drugs, spent trillions of dollars, given rise to the international underworld with almost nothing to show for it in terms of progress. The treatment possibilities that you've outlined here tonight I found very exciting and very encouraging. But I wonder if there's anybody watching to make sure it doesn't go too far. The Secretary Sudders talked about going to the medicine cabinet. What came to mind is, in a few years, kids being told in school to go to their parents' medicine cabinet and see what's there. It's only a matter of time before this becomes something more than voluntary and will probably become criminal if you have too many hydrocodones in your medicine cabinet. So I raise this as a question about the other side, the expansiveness of this program, which is getting underway now with much enthusiasm and much momentum. How do we know that it won't go too far and end up entrapping a whole bunch of innocent people who really are not part of the problem, but are caught up in this web of government surveillance and regulation?
Okay, that's a great question. I think it's for Secretary Sudders.
So let me give you just three comments. So one is, I didn't tell you to not vote for the legalization of marijuana. All I said was, when you go into the voting booth, just to pause and think. That's all I said. And told you where I stood. That's just me. Second is, 4 people die every day in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts at this time from an opioid overdose. 2.5 times more than someone dies from a car accident. So I don't think it's only affecting a few people. And that's just the people who die. I didn't put up the statistics of all the people who are in emergency rooms and the like. And I think you raise a very fair point around what is the role of government. And I guess I try to say that government has a role, but not the singular role. I actually believe that government has a limited role, and one of them happens to be is I don't believe that government should be in the space of developing what the research is, developing what the most efficacious treatments are, and really looking to others to help engage with us. So I guess that is part of my response to you. But I think it's one should always be. I've been in and out of public service. This is my 4th paid return. I've always considered myself a public servant. But I think one should always be slightly skeptical about what the role of government should be, because it can't and shouldn't be everything.
Okay, next question.
So, good evening. My name is Mark Tate. I'm here representing Avacor Healthcare. We are a specialty benefit management company who flipped specially for this because our company represents about 25% of the lives in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. So my question, and first of all, I want to say, Dr. Dimitri, thank you for bringing up, I'm a physical therapist by training, so thank you for bringing up the role that physical medicine can play. My question is for you about the evidence supporting the use of opioids for chronic pain, which is 12 weeks or longer, which I don't believe there is strong evidence for that. And then a lot of the solutions that I'm hearing, and passion is definitely evident that you all have for what you're doing, is the solutions upstream, because as physical therapists, we're trained to look at function and look at pain and to treat it. And so I think it's not just limited to physical therapy, there's other physical medicines, chiropractic, acupuncture, like you mentioned. So what role can they play in, hey, maybe give them that original opioid medication for the acute pain, but let's also get an assessment of the root cause of the pain to help improve that function.
Okay. Dr. Dimitri.
So to answer the first question, the evidence around the use of opioids for the treatment of chronic non-malignant pain is limited at best. There were a few studies that suggested this might be something you could do. There were some writings in the medical literature that said it could be done safely and at low risk of addiction. That's all data that's been pretty much debunked. And in fact, even within the medical literature, people have looked at some of these studies and been highly critical of the way they were put together and what they said. So I think that the consensus has been that the role for opioids in the treatment of chronic non-malignant pain is quite limited at best. And then with respect to the second part, I think that we need to make sure that physicians, when they're taking care of patients, have the time and the knowledge and the ability to sit down with their patient and have a discussion about their pain, why their pain may be bothering them so much, what are the other issues that may be exacerbating it, and what are the alternatives to treatment. Unfortunately, we are caught right now in a medical care system where the most precious commodity we have is time. There just is not enough of it between patients and their physicians, and oftentimes people want a quick solution, and for doctors it's easy to write a quick solution, which is a prescription. So changing the way the healthcare delivery system functions is another part of addressing physicians' abilities to use alternatives to prescribing for ongoing pain issues.
Okay, last question.
I'm Trudy Avery. I'm the National Development Officer for Care and Treatment Centers, so I spend every waking hour raising funds for scholarships for treatment, school prevention programs, and actually medical residency training in addiction.
Pennsylvania, is that right?
Care Correct. And treatment, yep. But I'm here tonight as the mother of a 28-year-old in long-term recovery, and I have to say thank you very, very much for all of your hard work. Amazing at some of the laws that have been changed. I will say, however, that I am a mother that ended up suing Blue Cross, taking them to the state attorney general in order to get the treatment that my son so desperately needed. With all the laws on the books, unless that one sentence in every insurer's contract that states what is deemed medically necessary, as long as that decision-making process sits in the hands of the insurers, nothing will change. Thank you.
Thank you.
Deb.
Yeah, Vic.
That's a really important point. In Chapter 258, the law I was speaking about earlier that was passed in 2014, a really key provision of that is that medical necessity determination for the first 14 to 21 days rests with the treating clinician and not with the insurer. And that was another key piece of that legislation.
All right. Thank you very much. Thank you, panelists. Thank you again.
Well, thank you all for joining us this evening, and thank you, Secretary Sudders and the rest of the great panel. What a sobering presentation about this all-pervasive epidemic. 10 years ago, donations made in my father's memory to the Pioneer Institute and the Beth Israel Deaconess Medical Center, the two organizations he chaired, were used for a lecture in healthcare to celebrate his life. Pioneer decided to keep it going. An eventful decade on, this series has covered key issues surrounding the huge and controversial developments at the intersection of healthcare and public policy. Tonight, this compelling presentation has been a worthy entry in that lexicon. Pioneer Institute's mission is an independent, nonpartisan research organization to improve the quality of life in Massachusetts through civic discourse, data-driven public policy solutions based on free market principles, and the ideal of effective, limited, and sustainable government. Independence means that Pioneer does not accept government grants, is not associated with, attached to any university, and does not do contract research. Instead, we address the issues we believe to be most pressing in the context of our mission. We're supported in our efforts by individuals and foundations who believe in our mission and in our ability to fulfill it. As our founding chairman, Pete Peters, would always admonish us at this point at the end of the evening, if what you've experienced tonight stimulates a generous impulse towards Pioneer, please act on it. As you leave, some members of the organization will be outside the theater to help provide additional information if you're interested in learning more. Thank you very much for coming. Good night.